There was somebody interested for the virtual conference, but we totally, myself and Ram.
Okay.
Ashok, meeting is live now?
Yeah, we are live now. Just a minute, let me update. So good evening and welcome to this 34th edition of MOA Masterclass. We have with us Dr. Ajit Shinde, President of MOA, and I request him to initiate the meeting. Go ahead, sir.
Good evening, friends. I, Dr. Ajit Shinde, President of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association, welcome all of you to MOA Masterclass series. We are discussing pediatric orthopedics, and today it's all about hip. We have experienced stalwarts, Dr. Taral Nagda and Dr. Sandeep Patwardhan as a convener, and Dr. Sapneel Kenny, Dr. Mandar Akashe, and Dr. Ashish Ranade as a moderators. DDS, Parthis are common pediatric hip entities which we see in our OPDs. One has to be very vigilant and precise to manage these cases for better outcome. Other than this, SCFE and proximal femoral focal deficiency are rather uncommon condition and need thorough evaluation and management. So today we will discuss all such cases, and I am sure our brilliant faculty will walk through all of it. Many a times the children are deprived of good medical facilities, particularly in peripheral setups. So my aim is to reach the peripheral part of our country where dedicated pediatric orthopedic surgeons are not available, so that general orthopedic surgeon can also treat these elements satisfactorily. So without wasting much time, let us begin the session. Over to Dr. Sandeep and Dr. Taranda. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. So good afternoon, everyone, for this masterclass on hip. And just for information, we have decided to split the hip into two seminars or two webinars. Today we are talking only on Parthis and DDH and some other conditions through cases, but traumatic hip, fracture of the hip, non-union of the hip, infections and SCFE, I think next week we will have another hip part two session. So today we will begin with management of the prosthetic hip, and I invite Sapneel Kenny to share his presentation for the first talk. Swapnil, unmute yourself. Swapnil, you're mute.
So, a very good evening to all the viewers. On behalf of everyone, may I thank Dr. Ajit Shinde and Dr. Narayan Karne for this wonderful masterclass, and our two masters, Dr. Sandeep Patwardhan and Dr. Taral Nagda. My talk is on decision making in early Parthes disease, which is the containable hips. Now, Parthes, as we all know, is a progressive, self-limiting, idiopathic avascular necrosis of the capital femoral epiphysis. By that, it means that the disease heals on its own. But there are certain problems and complications which arise during the process of this disease, which can give us trouble. Now, though we all know that Parthes heals on its own, but the natural history is unpredictable. There are some cases which present much late to us in the healing phase who have very, very minimal involvement with a little bit of an awkward gait. And there are some who present very, very early with significant stiffness and though the signs are subtle on radiology. Now, some have a completely benign outcome, whereas others tend to develop very severe arthritis. And we need to understand why this happens and what can we do to prevent these complications. Now, historically, what has been believed and what is still believed in many parts of this country and all over the world is that the treatment of Perthes is to do a varus derotation osteotomy. So the moment you see a Perthes, you need to contain it with doing a varus derotation osteotomy. However, the paradigm for these decision makings has changed over a period of time. And now we believe that there are four very important factors which help us make a decision in the diagnosis and management of Perthes disease. Age of the patient at the time of presentation, the stage of the disease, the area of the head involved and the shape of the capital femoral epiphysis, and also the findings of the hip on arthrography are extremely important decision-making parameters. Age of the patient is probably one of the most important parameters. A skeletal age of less than 6 years in literature has shown that any amount of severe head involvement will lead to a good result, even if you operate or you don't operate. And this has been proven in literature in the recent past, as well as by multiple authors over a period of time. As regards the state of the disease, Waldenstrom described the four stages of Perthes. We all know that. But today, that classification is obsolete. Today, we believe something which is a more workable classification, which is the modified Elizabethtown classification, modified by Benjamin Joseph from Manipal, who's a prominent pediatric orthopedic surgeon from this country. It is divided into four stages as per the natural progression of the disease. And the four stages are again divided into A and B. So let's look at each of the stages. Stage one is the stage of AVN or sclerosis, where there is no loss of height of the epiphysis. Stage 1B is sclerosis with loss of height. Stage 2A is early fragmentation, where you see one or two fissures. Stage 2B is advanced fragmentation, where the entire epiphysis is fragmented. Stage 3A is the early healing, where newborn formation is seen at the periphery of the femoral head, and there is some amount of osteoporosis. Stage 3B is late healing, where more than one third of the femoral epiphysis is healed and newborn formation is seen. And stage 4 is complete healing with no radiologically identifiable avascular necrosis. Now, the Elizabethtown classification, if you look at it, it actually tells us that the Perthes disease can last for anywhere between 2 to 2.5 years. But the defining line essentially comes in the first year, that is in the early fragmentation stage, or the Elizabethtown 2A. You need to remember this, because this is basically the watershed area beyond which probably a hip is not salvageable and not containable. Area of head involvement is basically defined now by the lateral pillar classification of Herring's, which divides the capital femoral epiphysis, which is visible on X-ray, into three equal pillars: the medial, the central, and the lateral. Now, the type A or the mild variety is when the lateral pillar is completely intact. The Herring's B is 50% of the pillar is intact, which is the moderate variety. And the C, Herring's C, is less than 50% of the femoral head involved. More than 50% of the femoral lateral pillar involved. And this means that there is instability and extrusion of the femoral head. So the third point which I'm going to make here is about arthrogram. And arthrogram tells us three things. It makes us decide about the three C's, which is the congruency, the containment, and the coverage. But the crux of decision-making is basically to divide these hips into containable and non-containable hips, depending upon the age of presentation. So the age less than 6 years, any stage of the disease, however severe, everything is good. Even if you operate them or don't operate them, most of them turn out to be well by skeletal maturity and even later in life. Age more than 6 years up to stage 2A and the head is spherical on arthrogram, you can do a varus derotation osteotomy to contain this head. If age is more than 6 years beyond stage 2A, head is still spherical, you can still do an arthrogram. The non-containable hips, which Dr. Sandeep Patodhan will be speaking, is beyond stage 2A, or when there is hinged abduction or complete collapse, where a VDRO cannot be done and you have to do other procedures. Now let's look at this first case. This is a case of a 5-year-old child. This is a Herring's this is a stage 1B Elizabethtown. This is a Herring's B. Predictive outcome is excellent. And this was treated in a swash brace, and eventually went on to do well, went on to heal well with minimal disability. The second case is a 7-year-old boy of Perthes disease. There was terminal restriction of internal and external rotation, headings B with lateral extrusion possible and Elizabethtown 1B. Now this is the left side which is involved. And now you can see that there is an extrusion of the femoral head on the left side. So based upon this, it was decided to do an arthrography to see the sphericity, whether this head was containable and whether the coverage was reasonably good. And an arthrogram was planned. So the way you do an arthrogram is basically you prep and drape the hip. It is done in the operating room. You mark the femoral artery so that you do not go into it. You need to stay lateral to it. You have to have a water-soluble contrast media with equal concentration of water and the contrast medium. This is what you require. The center of the femoral head and neck junction is identified on a C-arm. Once you do that, you take a 20-gauge vein flow, attach it to a syringe, and insert it vertically at the center of the head-neck junction, and then inject about 2 or 3 cc of air, which gives you an air arthrogram. So the air arthrogram actually tells you whether the needle is inside the capsule of the hip and whether the dye which you're going to eventually inject, whether it is going to go inside. So this is an air arthrogram. You choose the head-neck junction. The capsule is way beyond this. And once you do that, you take about 2 or 3 cc of air. And once you inject that air, you will see that the entire capsule is being lined by the air. And this tells us that the needle is inside the capsule, that is inside the intracapsular. And now you can safely inject your dye. Once that is done, about 7 to 8 ml of water soluble contrast is injected. And you can check the hip range of motion. So with the same needle, you now inject water-soluble contrast. And when it was done in this particular case, you can see that the contrast is lining the capital femoral epiphysis. And you can clearly see that this is a spherical epiphysis. Now you, of course, need to put this to the range of motion of the hip to see the lateral side, the posterior part. So what you do is once this is done, you check for the hip range of motion. If you see the hip can be contained and if there is coverage. So you put it through the entire range of motion. You know that this is a spherical hip and therefore it's a containable hip. It's a Herring's one, it's a Elizabethtown 1B. So the treatment for this based upon all these findings is going to be a varus derotation osteotomy like was done for this case. Now planning of VDRO, it can either be done on a paper planning or it can even be done in the operating room. So this is a patient who has a right-sided Perthes disease. You can see this X-ray on the lateral side. There is definitely a collapse. There is definitely an extrusion. And the head seems to be extruded. And you can see that this is, again, early fragmentation, probably a 2A. You put this through the range of motion and see at what angle of abduction are you going to get coverage. So in this scenario, at about 30 degrees of abduction, you are getting a contained hip. So that is the amount of abduction which you need to give or the amount of varus you need to give in the proximal fragment. So you're going to do that. Then the next thing you do is take the patient in supine position, mark the trochanter, mark the incision. This incision is very, very similar to an intertrochanteric fracture exposure. You expose the tensor fascia lata, make a small nick in the tensor fascia lata, go through the TFL to expose the vastus lateralis. Once the vastus lateralis is exposed, you need to open the lateral cortex of the femur by making an L-shaped incision in the vastus lateralis. So that is the vastus lateralis seen. You make an L-shaped incision. You cut the superficial fibers of the vastus lateralis. Once that is done, you can then elevate the remaining fibers from the femoral shaft and you will reach the periosteum of the bone. Now, once that is done, the next step is slightly different. You need to remember that in a child, the periosteum is quite thick. So the periosteum needs to be opened. It's a nice thick flap, as you can see there. So the periosteum needs to be opened and you need to go subperiosteally. You also need to see the trochanter, because most of our surgeries now we do a trochanteric epiphyseodesis. And the reason for that is so that you don't get a trochanteric overgrowth and that does not cause you coxa breva. So you also expose the lateral part of the trochanter by elevating a part of the gluteus medius so that you can place your plate. So just the central fibers of the gluteus medius are kind of elevated, which will be sutured back later once the surgery is done. The next step is basically putting the wires. So your first wire is your trochanteric epiphyseodesis wire. This wire also helps you to hook the plate onto the bone so that the plate stays there when you are fixing it to the bone. So this is your trochanteric wire. This is your second wire, which is your neck wire, which helps you give control. And your third wire is your derotation wire, because if you have to remember that this is not a varus osteotomy only, it's a varus derotation osteotomy, where you either internally rotate the proximal fragment or externally rotate the distal fragment. Once you do that, you decide what is your level of the osteotomy. Usually it is at the level of the lesser trochanter or slightly below. You need to mark that particular point. And once you mark that particular point, you can either use a saw, or if you feel that the bone is quite thin, you can use multiple drill holes. I personally use multiple drill holes. You also tend to mark the center of the lateralmost cortex of the femur so that when you do a derotation maneuver, you have a checkerine effect there so that you get the amount of derotation you require. Normally about 10 to 15 degrees of derotation is required to give about a 30 degree angle to the plate. Now many people tend to give the angle slightly below the level of the osteotomy so that the distal fragment is medialized. It depends upon your training. So this is the first angle. Your second angle is going to be the angle which is required for the plate to sit. Now, many a times, many people do not give this angle. They just keep a straight plate there and use a thinner plate, then probably the plate will contour, but I'm using a DCP here, so it may not contour. So once this is done, you do your osteotomy, multiple drill holes as shown in this case. And the next thing is you can use a saw, or you can complete your osteotomy with the help of an osteotome. The reason for doing an osteotome is you can control the osteotomy and you can also see under the C-arm. So when I distract the osteotomy, you will see on the C-arm picture that I can see that my hip is getting contained. I can also see there that the hip is getting contained. My osteotomy is completely open and the hip, which is basically was extruded, is now going inside, is getting contained. I'm doing my derotation maneuver. And once I do my derotation maneuver, then I put my plate, the hook, the K-wire there acts as a hook to hold the plate on. And once my plate is put on and my derotation maneuver is done, I tend to fix it with multiple screws, at least 2 to 3 in the distal cortex, depending upon the age of the patient, distal fragment, and about 2 to 3 in the proximal fragment. And that is your final picture. So that is neutral position where your hip is completely contained. So that is one way of doing a varus derotation osteotomy, the simplest way of doing it. So to summarize my talk, the age of the presentation, the stage of the disease, and arthrographic findings are the defining characters which help us prognosticate Perthes disease. Arthrogram, as I've shown, is a very simple yet powerful tool. It defines and delineates the dynamics of the hip joint. And definitely these criteria, including arthrogram, have a definite role in surgical management, because it tells the surgeon whether hip is containable or not, whether it needs to be covered, or whether you have to perform any sort of salvage procedures. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Swapnil. That was very nice. You could manage to show the surgery also. So thanks for that. And I think we'll just move on to the next talk here so that we don't waste time and I can give more time to Taral to discuss cases. So can you see my screen now?
Yes, Sandeep, very well, sir. Yeah.
Okay. So post-Perthes hip, the second chance is to talk about what happens when the hip is one not containable or second healed up. Do we give up and say that nothing can be done? Let's understand what happens after Perthes heals. It's been shown that osteoarthritis happens in about 30 to 50% of hips with Perthes disease, and impingement seems to be the most common of arthrosis in the post-perthetic hip because of irregular shape of the head. During the primary stages of disease, as Swapnil has pointed out, containment is an extremely useful concept. But the fun part about Perthes is that the biology doesn't follow mechanics all the time. Some biological factors are beyond our control, and containment is effective in maintaining roundness of the head only in 62.5% of cases. So what you have to understand is that if you don't do containment and leave it for masterly inactivity, only 20% may end up spherical. If you do containment, you will get about 63% sphericity. There is still a large number who won't become spherical even despite containment. So the question is, how do we tackle those? At the stage of primary healing, it is very important to assess the condition of the hip. What are we dealing with? This is the Stuhlbarg classification. Are we dealing with a hip which is spherical and congruous, which means round on round, and this should last you 50 plus years of your life? Is it aspherical but congruous, which means the surfaces are matching each other? They are not round as in spherical. They are oval, but at least they match up to each other. This can be achieved by coverage procedures. Or have you ended up with a hip that is neither spherical nor congruous, which is the worst thing that can happen to a Perthes hip, and this will end up with severe arthritis as early as the third decade. So our aim always is to make the hip spherical and congruous. But if you can't, at least try to make it aspherical but congruous. Never leave a hip which is neither spherical nor congruous. So what happens is that the child is healed, the symptoms are often mild till late adolescence, the motion is sort of okay, and the orthopedic surgeon is reluctant to do any further treatment or doesn't know what to do. And all is well seems to be the motto here, and people are sent off. But what is the true thing, what is the true situation in that hip? The hip is actually impinging and abrading cartilage. The acetabulum, which is initially mildly dysplastic, can become more and more damaged. And the prognosis of this hip now remains depends on how badly the hip is impinging. So let's look at the sequelae of Perthes disease. You can either end up having a coxa magna like this. You have a very large head but reasonable roundness. It's slightly oval, but it is overgrown, as seen here. The second is coxa irregularis, where you have a misshapen head. Okay, so something like an extrusion or a bump anterolateral, which is now going to impinge severely when Indian people, especially when the child tries to sit on the floor cross-legged or on long duration walking and sports. Sometimes you get coxa brevis with trochanteric overgrowth, which means a very short neck and a high ridden trochanter, which causes extra articular impingement and further problems. So that is another issue. Then you can end up with true hinge abduction. When you say hinge abduction, what happens is that the fulcrum shifts from center of head to the anterolateral corner. And when you abduct, the medial joint space actually opens and the head is impinging anterolaterally on the acetabular labrum and abrading it and causing tears and more and more damage to the hip. So this is what happens. Either the head, if it is soft, it gets completely deformed like this, and this is how it ends up into arthritis. Sometimes you get osteochondritis dissecans, a loose necrotic fragment which just separates out from the parent cartilage and bone and can cause intra-articular sort of a foreign body. So this needs to be tackled by arthroscopy sometimes. This is very rare. And to sum it up, all this is going to end up eventually causing degenerative arthritis. What causes pain? Irregularity of that head, hinged abduction, trochanteric impingement, extra-articular and true intra-articular femoroacetabular impingement. And then that leads to arthritis because you have an incongruent hip joint or reduced femoral head coverage and excessive stresses which are damaging the joint. What are the treatment options? Or as we call the second chance or hip preservation. How do you tackle trochanteric overgrowth? All of these problems have different solutions. As Swapnil has pointed out, Benjamin Joseph has always advocated primary trochanteric epiphyseodesis at the time of varus osteotomy. But these are the other ways where you can drill, staple, or put a screw Unfortunately, the trochanteric growth is not great after 8 or 9 years. So all these epiphyseal disease methods later on as standalone may or may not work. This is what should be done. You shave off the flare and put a screw which compresses the physis when you're doing the VDRO itself so that the overgrowth is stopped and it actually lateralizes. But when you have a healed perthes, you need to advance the trochanter. So you do a trochanteric advancement, you do an osteotomy with the abductors and bring that fragment distally and laterally. And then you put screws so that the biomechanics are improved, the abductor lurch goes away and the extra articular impingement is prevented or reduced. So this is how it heals. This is another case. You can see the coxa vara and the trochanteric overgrowth. And then at the lower X-ray, you can see how the trochanter has been distalized and lateralized to give a much better mechanical axis and better abductor lever function, taking away the trochanteric impingement. If you have a large head, now when you have the perthes in the 2B or the 3A or the 4 stage, you have an incongruous hip. Doing a varus osteotomy here is not going to help. But then do you leave them alone? You can improve their coverage by doing a shelf. So this is an example where the head is flattened. It does not really go in, but if I do about 40-50 degree abduction, I can still allow the hip to slip in, as you can see on this arthrogram. So arthrography also helps you here. Is this containable extrusion or is it true hinge abduction where the medial joint space actually opens up? If you are able to slip that head in extreme abduction, you can't do a varus osteotomy which makes the neck shaft angle 90 degrees. So what you need to do is then put a small roof on that area and allow that to become an oval kind of an acetabulum to adequately cover the oval head which is going to form. So you have aspherical congruity. So that is his result eventually, and he gets a decent function. This is not the best hip, but it will last better than aspherical incongruity. Another example, an impinging left hip. You can see the large bump here, and this is the shelf that has been put on it. And this is his longer follow-up with a much better coverage of the enlarged head and a good function as of now. So we'll still have to observe this hip. So lateral shelf abuloplasty has been proven to show good results in most of the cases. And the extreme amount of shelf is the Chiari osteotomy. So even Chiari can be done, which does very well in enlarged head. So this is an example of a 12-year-old girl who had a subluxed hip with a large head, as you can see here, and we did a translation of the pelvis and a Chiari, put in a screw there, and that's how it healed eventually to give her a decent function. And she hasn't come back since. She's all right now. She must be about 18 or 20 years old. True hinge abduction is where, as I told you, there is an anterolateral bump and the center of rotation now shifts from center of head to anterolateral head and medial joint space is opening. You are not able to get the hip in the socket. So how do you tackle that bump? You have two options. One, do a valgus osteotomy, get the bump out of the way, or reshape the head. So this example, which I showed you earlier with an anterolateral bump there, what you can do is adduct the proximal fragment. That gives you a much better sphericity and congruity. And then do a valgus osteotomy. So proximal femoral valgus osteotomy can be done, which takes away the bump and allows better contact of healthy cartilage. The disadvantage is that this creates more stresses on the head because of the valgus neck shaft and can make the hip unstable sometimes. So you need to watch out for that. If you are going to do femoral head reshaping, which was the second option, you have three approaches. You can do it from front, you can do it by an arthroscope, or you can use the safe surgical dislocation approach. We'll discuss more when Taral shows you. So in this particular case, you can see that there is a huge anterolateral bump there. I chose to do an anterior surgery here. I went in and I removed that anterolateral bump and I distalized the trochanter and did a sort of a true neck lengthening here. Though I didn't really lateralize the shaft, I brought the trochanter down and took away a large amount of that bump. And that is how it healed over a period of time. And that is the final when implants were removed. So she maintains good range of motion, no pain, and she's got a very decent looking hip right now, which will last her at least 15 to 20 years, hopefully. Another example of a bad hip post perthes, a Breva with a flattened head. Again, we did a true neck lengthening here. I lateralized the shaft as well as took away the bump, and that is how she is at present. She's walking pretty okay. Again, these are usually adolescent children or young adults where she couldn't sit cross-legged and had a lot of pain, and that has gone away. So the plain x-ray does show that the hip is not absolutely perfect, but I expect this to last much better, and her symptoms of impingement have gone away. So we can definitely help the children in these particular ways. You can also, if you're good at arthroscopy, you can take away the bump through an arthroscope. Do an arthroscopic osteochondroplasty. That's an example where abduction and axial rotation was restored. This case was done by Dinsha. I had sent him away because nobody was doing it at that time in Pune. And finally, the black box surgery, or the safe surgical dislocation, which has now allowed us to open the hip, dislocate it, take away what looks bad, reshape the head, put a couple of Herbert screws, and put everything back. So a really powerful surgery, which is tackling the pathology at the level that it exists, with a small risk of causing chondrolysis if you do it very early in the active stage of Perthes. So I would always caution that you do it when the head is healed or reconstituted. So this is an example of coxa magna with impingement, where we have taken the hip out and then we have took away a segment and reduced the volume of the head, and distalize the trochanter and done a relative neck lengthening along with that. That's how it healed. If the head damage exceeds 50% or there is global damage, you have only two options: arthrodesis, or you have to do excision because the hip is simply non-salvageable. We don't prefer arthrodesis in our country. I go for excision arthroplasty with a valgusization, and children do pretty decently, and we've had a lot of cases with good restoration of function, in the sense they can sit cross-legged, can walk. They do have a little lurch, but they become pain-free, and coming from rural backgrounds, they're pretty happy with what happens. To summarize, the second chance is that recognize that you can improve function and prognosis even after the head is healed. Absence of pain does not mean everything is well mechanically or prognostically. The hip can still go bad. You need to follow up. And to do nothing with the hip that is impinging is allowing irreversible damage, which can often be avoided. Asphericity is the problem, and the interior of the hip is no longer a black box. You can use the SSD tool to reshape the head. Thank you very much.
You know, thanks Sandeep and Swapnil. You know, so both the heads together have put this very well. Swapnil taught us what is the basic pathology in Perthes. How do you stage them? How do you classify them? And how do you decide how to treat? Question, Swapnil, for you is, Swapnil, we all the time talk about so many treatment options for Perthes, right? 100 years have passed, more than 100 years since the time Perthes was discovered. Tell me, is there actually really any cure for Perthes disease, or we are trying to only salvage the situations and prevent the sequelae? Can you treat Perthes disease?
Right. So, as I said, unlike adult avascular necrosis, Perthes is self-limiting. So, the blood supply which has been hampered will eventually, there will definitely be a revascularization in these cases. However, the problem essentially lies is when the head tends to become soft during the early phases of Perthes. That is where the problem lies. And this head tends to subluxate outwards, causing flattening, subluxation, and loss of shape. So Perthes per se, you cannot treat it, but definitely the problems which may arise if you pick it up in time, if the patient comes to you early and if it's a young child, then definitely you can get a near normal hip. If the child does not come to you within time and the stage of the Perthes is beyond the 2A, then still we have shown, and as per our recent understanding, recent literature, and what we have learned from the West, we can still do a reasonably good job at salvaging these hips. So eventually the idea is probably to try and delay osteoarthritis and try and delay a total hip arthroplasty. So that is the basic idea of managing Perthes.
Okay, thanks, Swapnil. Swapnil, you know, one thing I just want to clarify with the audience, that we have a large audience here, people practicing from different areas of the country in different domains is that, of course, Swapnil said that young age means good results. So in Parthis and Corona, if you are younger, you know, the chances that the disease will hit you is lesser, but it is not always so. We also see 35 and 40 year old people getting affected from Corona and dying. Similarly, young age is not a free ticket to Parthi's disease. You know, you must realize that if you are 6 year plus, the chance of a bad result is 60%. In a younger child, it's still 30%. So a child who is young with Parthi's disease must still be kept under surveillance, must still be kept with range of motion exercises, must still be prevented from weight bearing. And if you see extrusion, still there is a role for doing virus osteotomy, even if the child is less than 6 years.
Sir, a question to faculty, if it permitted.
Absolutely.
So, what is the role of advanced imaging in early Parthis? Do you do it regularly? Many a time we have patients who come to us with MRI, which has been done. So, is there a role of MRI or a CT in, especially in early Parthis?
So, I will just add to Mandar's question: is that a lot of time when we see patients come with X-ray and MRI done, are people doing MRI because they don't understand what is to be done? Or there is a role? Yeah, Swapnil, go ahead. Your answer.
I think my indication is quite limited for an MRI. I would probably do it only in stiff Parthis. A young stiff Parthis where I don't really find a reason, and not responding to, say, conservative line of management and physiotherapy, that would probably be my only indication for an MRI. It means I'm trying to differentiate between Parthis and something else. Now, there is an entity called as Parthis type of tuberculosis, where the tuberculous hip, which is very common in our country, looks like Parthis. So that is one probable indication which I can think of offhand where I would probably do an MRI. In a straightforward case of Parthis, I may not do it in the early stage, of course. Later on, if I want to see any labral injuries or any sort of a cartilage problem, that is where I would do an MRI.
So can I show a case? You know, in fact, my first case was where we were talking about role of MRI. And nowadays, we are not doing MRI to diagnose Parthis. Parthis is diagnosed clinically or on X-rays. But we are doing special vascular studies on MRI.
Yeah.
To study what is the perfusion index. Can I share a case and then can continue with further discussion and then other cases on Parthis?
Yeah, just one point here. Like Swapnil said, sometimes you get a very young child with recurrent hip synovitis, and the plain X-ray has not yet revealed a density change, or it is too subtle for the general orthopedic surgeon to pick it up. I have seen many a time general orthopedic surgeons get an MRI because they don't know what's happening. And then that shows Parthis to them, the infarct and the... So per se, if there's an experienced pediatric orthopedic surgeon, I don't think he's going to get an MRI done for routine Parthis disease. But as he said, differentiation. And second, MR arthrography for vascular studies. And if you're going to think of injecting or you want to see whether it is revascularizing. Taral, go ahead.
Yeah, absolutely. So this work has been inspired by Professor Kim from Texas Scottish Rite Institute. And now he has a Parthis disease protocol for early Parthis, and we are part of this. So, you know, this is something which I, you know, sort of picked up way back in 2004. And since then, we have been using MRI to diagnose ischemia, quantify it, and then inject zoledronic acid in this ischemic hips to prevent the collapse. So this work was presented at last POSI meeting and got the second best poster award. But I'm just going to show you a case here. So this was a child, 7-year-old, who had hip pain. And if you see, this is the time when, Swapnil, would you agree? This is stage 1A, that is sclerosis, but hardly any changes in the height.
Absolutely.
So this is when we saw the child, and then the child was put on range of movement exercise, young child. So we just wanted to observe. And as we followed up the child, we found that, you know, now the size of the head was on measurements was reducing. And what we decided at that time was to follow Kim's protocol. And when we got MRI done. So what is the difference between normal T1 and T2 image in perfusion scan? So these are normal T1 and T2 images, which diagnoses perfusion, which tells you that this is Parthis, this is stage of ischemia, femoral head is round, and you know what you will do is you will say that there is no extrusion, and you will decide what is to be done further. If it's a young child, you will just observe. If it's an old child, you may do an early osteotomy for this child. You do a perfusion scan, you give gadolinium and do the perfusion scan, your complete visualization changes. So if you see here, in this MRI image, there is a stark difference between the right and the left side. And you can quantify the amount of vascularization. You see here, this the person who did MRI showed us that the amount of vascularity of this head is only 25%. And lateral head, there was no vascularity. So this is head at risk. And what we did for this case is, take this patient. So by the time, patient could decide that this is to be done. And by the time we concluded, we saw that some further collapse was happening. And then we said, this is 2A, we can't wait further. And then we communicated with Professor Kim. We took this child under anesthesia. We did an arthrogram, which proved that the femoral head was rounded. Though the capital femoral epiphysis was flattened, the head was not flat. The cartilage was good. And in that case, we did multiple drilling into the femoral head using 2mm K wires. From the same track, we passed J needle, and using a pressure injector, we injected around 5 cc of solidranic acid, which was diluted in 100 cc. So you end up injecting around 0.5 milligram or so into the femoral head. This is done very slowly over a period of 10 to 15 minutes. Patient generally gets little synovitis and fever for 2 to 3 days after this procedure. And you can see this is the follow-up at 4 months. The child was kept non-weight bearing. We encourage range of movement exercises. And then you can see over a period of 5 months, 1 year, and this is 1.5 years, the femoral head, which was flattening, is now sort of re-ossifying. You don't see any further collapse. And that over a long period, now we have almost a 5 year follow-up of this child. She has perfectly spherical head, goes into Stuttgart 1 and has no problem. So this is not one child. We have done similarly almost around 25 cases. And we found that in early, which means 1A, 1B and 2A, this is a good option. If the femoral head sphericity is maintained and if there is no extrusion.
Taral, if I can add something some comments.
Yeah, please.
So since this is an MOA meeting, first thing is that perfusion scans and contrast gadolinium are not the same. The software is different to run a perfusion scan. So it's not you give contrast and at that tells you perfusion.
Yeah.
Second, there is no comparative study which says that the hips which are in 1A would have just like that also become spherical without the intervention. So intraosseous zoledronic acid is still at a very experimental level. I wouldn't give the message people will start injecting that all across Maharashtra or the country.
So this is part of a study group. Yeah.
Yeah, that's it's a study. It's happening. I have tried it in 4 or 5 cases and it didn't work. The head still went on. It just became dense. But the disease did collapse and there was some extrusion. Patient is clinically fine, but radiologically what it is supposed to do, stop the osteoclastic resorption and preserve the head shape. That did not happen. It still happened. With the dense head, it collapsed. So it's not consistent. I wouldn't say this is a therapeutic option for everybody. Absolutely. To be done. Right. So a word of caution there.
Right. Absolutely. So the whole research nowadays is towards, salvaging the head, preserving the vascularity and preserving the integrity. So that's what is the future of Perthes. Now we go on to the second case. I would request Govardhan to share his slides. So from an ischemic head, now we are going on to extruded head, and he has a case to discuss with us, and we will discuss what the case had, and we will also discuss what was the management adopted by him, and debate whether that was the right thing to do. Can you share your slides?
Yes. Actually, this case is Shindesar's case. He has sent it to me yesterday only. To present to have a very good discussion on Perthes, because we have talks on this. So this sir's case actually, which I will be presenting on his behalf. So this was a 12-year boy with LUT.
Govardhan, can you go ahead?
Yeah, we can't hear him.
We can't hear him, he's frozen. Yeah. Nothing is moving.
There is a problem with his connection.
Dr. Shinde, can you present? I have his slides. Ashok, if you can unshare his screen.
Ashok?
So I'll just share his slides. Dr. Shinde, if you can present the case, it will be... Govardhan?
He's left the meeting, I think.
No problem.
I think some internet issues.
No issue. So Dr. Shinde, will you present this case? Yeah. So I have the slides here. Yes, sir. Dr. Shinde, please. I'm putting the slides for you, if you can.
Actually, theoretically, I am not prepared for this because I was busy with the IOA meeting preparation. Even then, I will tell what has been done.
Right, sir.
A 12-year male came with the complaints of right hip pain, restriction of movements, not able to walk properly, not able to participate in school activities. There is a shortening. Patient has a shortening gait and hip range of movement are restricted. No history of tuberculosis or any other. Next. These are the various X-rays which shows cogna magna breva, then fragmentation of the femoral epiphysis and head is not well covered and changes of Perthes, advanced Perthes are seen. And next slide.
Oh, yeah. So I'm just going to magnify these X-rays because, you know, we couldn't so see well on these X-rays. So these are the X-rays. So Swapnil, I'm going to ask you, you know, what stage, you spoke about stages of Perthes. So where do you place this?
So this is probably now starting to reossify. So I would probably put it as around 3A. Because I can see some ossification at the periphery. I can also see that there is some osteopenia. And the problem here is that this is a flat head. It is extruding and probably in the stage of healing. So most likely this is probably a bit beyond containment is what I
So you think of varus derotation is not a good procedure for this hip, right? And it is almost completely collapsed. So it is stage three, more than 50% collapse.
Yes,
so Sandeep, what? How would you manage this? You know, what would?
Yeah. So I agree with Swapnil completely. Looks like 3A with a short, wide neck and a flatter head. So if the child is symptomatic, I would definitely consider doing a shelf acetabuloplasty for this, for anterolateral coverage. That
Mandar,
would be my treatment of choice. Yeah.
So Mandar, do you agree with Sandeep, you know, that he says,
sir,
that he will treat, it's a femoral problem and you are treated on the acetabular side, you
Absolutely.
Know, kiski galti aur kisko saza mil. So
sir,
do you
here,
agree with him?
Yeah, here, sir, if you look at the X-ray, there is a small flake of bone which is there on the lateral edge of the femoral head.
Right.
So that as Swapnil said, shows that it is a reossifying head, and it itself, if we can do an MRI, it will be a big coxa magna. So a coxa magna is going to be having a significant amount of edge loading at that point. And that is where it is better that if we give some form of cover over a big over the big femoral head, it should at least prevent further damage from happening. Though the exact mechanism of why a shelf works, it is still debatable. Because it's just a rack of bone which we are putting over the capsule. But even then, it has been shown to have fairly good results. At least it's like a good salvage procedure in these hips.
Okay. So, you know, both of you want to cover this part. Now, one thing I want to just say is, you know, this trochanter is higher up,
right,
as compared to the other side. The neck is shorter.
Yeah.
So after shelf procedure, is the child likely to have certain limp? Do you anticipate? Of course, you know, you have covered the head, but the limp, about the limp, what do you do? Because, you know, Govardhan very well presented that this child came with a limp and waddling it, you know, though it was misspelled, but it was the right complaint. So how do you address that complaint, the problem which the parents have come with?
Sir, he still has some amount of growth left. So we can at the same time do something like a trochanteric epiphysodesis at the same time.
At 12 years age? 12
years age, so that's what, so have... I mean, or a trochanteric distalization. Again, I'll not do it at the same time as a trochanteric distalization. At the most, probably do a trochanteric physiodesis and then wait for what happens with the shelf and how it helps with the coverage.
Govardhan, are you there? Can you explain further? Otherwise, Dr. Shinde, we see that he has good range of movement. And then his MRI was done as, you know, Banda rightly said. Can you see this magnified image here? The MRI shows that there is, of course, a spherical head, ovoid head, but lot of extrusion happening there. And then this is CT scan, which was done. And this is how it was treated. A shelf was created, which was treated with wire. Dr. Shinde, you want to just, can you explain our viewers what exactly you did and steps of the procedures?
We opened the... We didn't open the hip joint. We just create the flap of the iliac bone and we with additional bone graft and we covered anterolaterally the over the capsule the head part.
Right. So I see a very interesting concept here, supporting the shelf with an internal fixator. You know, I want to ask Sandeep, do you think you know, you would just do a shelf and leave it loose hanging, or you would use something like this to support the shelf? What do you do exactly when you operate?
So when we do a shelf, I don't think it is hanging because we make a slot and we put the graft in such a way that it self stabilizes most of the times. So there are we have done screw fixation, plate fixation. But I feel that it involves an additional procedure of removing the implant, and being anteriorly quite superficial, the plate screws can bother the child, especially while walking. The rectus rubs against that, or your sartorius rubs against that. So I have evolved, and I have probably now what I do is I do layered shelves. So I put one on the capsule and then make a slot and put one more above that. It's like a step ladder.
Right.
You do, like I showed in one case, so I put 2-3 grafts as much as possible, as if I'm extending the anterior column of from ASIS to AIS.
Right.
Try to bring it a little more in front to cover it a little better. And at the end of when I punch in my graft, I try to move it. Usually the whole pelvis moves, which means it's self-stabilized. So I don't give, I just leave them with a long leg knee brace.
So very important concept here, that like a mason prepares to put a marble sort of a shelf into the wall, he creates a slot and puts that granite or marble shelf. Similarly, your preparation of the slot is very important.
It is very important, yes. At the angle the level, both.
So what angle is that? What angle is crucial?
About 20 degree inclination upwards is my angle. And so we have found that the part of the bone which is unloaded resorbs over a period of time. You will find that you have put in a lot of graft. After 1 year, you will see some of it, but the volume of the acetabulum is better.
Right. So it has to be in the direction of weight bearing. Yeah, any other tips, Mandar, when you do shelf? Is there anything else?
Share one picture.
Yeah, please
I'll just
do that.
I'll show you one of my presentations.
Absolutely. So what we'll do once we...
Mandar, you can just...
Mandar, you can say what I'll do. I'll just show what was done. And this is a longer follow-up, which shows that. So we'll ask.
Sir, there is one more hitch in that case. You see the last slide, actually.
Yeah, we will come to that. So, yes.
So Swapnil, this is what Sandeep sir was saying, actually. So first layer, second layer, then rectus femoris comes over it, then the abductor mechanism. So this is what he meant by a layered shelf.
Not exactly like this, Swapnil. I put not the cancellous graft there. I put 2-3 slotted steps.
Absolutely. This is just one case which I've done.
Shelf is a very important procedure because, you know, the more exotic procedures, a general orthopedic surgeon, as Sandeep was saying, you know, people from peripheries, people in district places, people in district level hospitals are watching this. They may not be able to do exotic procedures, but shelf, if well learned, can be done very well by yes. a general orthopedic surgeon with good results. Absolutely. And it's important. And I would request Dr. Shinde that actually we should have a surgical workshop on simple surgical procedures, which can be done in district level hospitals. And this is one of them. You can't go much wrong here. Okay, so Hitch, in this case, I'm going to share the screen again. So we'll ask Govardhan to do the talking. Govardhan, can you see these slides? And what?
Yes,
what
sir. If you see on the opposite side, right. now it has landed up in arthritis right. and collapse. Yeah.
Right.
So now the problem is not with the right hip. Now the problem is in the left hip.
Right.
This is what he's in the recent follow-up now with this arthritic hip. So have you seen late onset perthes bilateral? Or it is something else, or it is something, some systemic problem already existing.
I'm going to ask Swapnil first and then other faculties to comment on this. Is this perthes? Can it be something else?
Be something else. Yeah, could be something else. Not necessarily perthes, maybe a sickle cell or something of that sort. Something not very
can we go to back perthes? to the x-rays whether
if you see the x-ray post of 9 months, the hip was quite okay.
Yeah,
this is a preoperative x-ray. Next.
So we do know that perthes is bilateral in quite a few cases, and it may start at the same time.
Right. No, if you see the previous slide, this is after 9 months post-op. So that time the hip was absolutely okay.
If the child is short stature, and if both hips are simultaneously involved, it's likely to be spondyloepiphyseal dysplasia. But if they come at different times, like here it is at different times, this is likely that this is perthes. Secondly, this person may be at risk for getting perthes. See, many times we are not able to diagnose. But nowadays, of course, there are some genetic studies which are being done, and you can identify a person at risk for perthes. So, though it's not a genetic disorder, the at-risk character can come from genetics.
So this is something. The shelf hip did well.
Shelf hip has done very well. Yeah, shelf
not landed up in arthritis.
Absolutely. So joint space is very good. What will you do for the left side? Left. Sandeep, I'm going to ask you.
It depends on what is the clinical finding now. One is... And here probably an MRI would help. Is there some healthy cartilage? There seems to be a very big bump there.
Right.
So we can think of osteochondroplasty and restoration if there is good cartilage on that. And I think that will help.
The arthroscopic will be a better option.
So any arthroscopies are open. We'll ask Mandar.
Is a better option as a mean Mandar.
But.
Mandari,
too large means, of course, you have to be good at hip arthroscopy for that. It's not something ki are, let's do it. I have not seen. See, that is why hip arthroscopy is not so popular. Hardly all our big arthroscopies, they are all limited to the knee only. Nobody goes into the hip.
At the neck.
Sir, if I think this child must be about 18 years of age or so.
Right, he's a mature.
So he's a skeletally mature person. And if you see the AP X-ray, you will see that there is this big sagging rope sign,
right,
which shows that there is a significant amount of anterior overhang.
Right.
Just at the intertrochanteric line. Yeah. So that is this big sagging rope sign. So when the proper indication for doing an osteochondroplasty is that there is a small localized sort of protrusion or a bump where you can just shave it off. Such sort of severe anterior bumps is very difficult to go even with a surgical dislocation approach and give a good result.
Right.
Probably at around 18 or 19, this is probably beyond the stage of a hip preservation and just probably pain relief or range of motion exercise till the time he presents with further arthritis is what I'll do.
Okay, so he may be a candidate for hip replacements if he gets painful on the left side.
I want to add 2-3 things, Taral.
Yes, sir.
One thing is that previous MRI was normal at that time, NAD on opposite side. And he was being investigated for hormone study because pediatrician was suspecting parathormone involvement, and that time the reports were normal.
Right. So it's not a metabolic or endocrinological problem, we understand. But there is a this is Perthes, this is avascularity, and the left side is more involved. And you see now decrease in joint space, it's a cartilage which is unhealthy, and it's a global disease. It's not just anterolateral disease, it's a global disease, which is unlikely to do well with salvage procedures. Right. Mandar, share your case so that you know we can sort of come to these thought processes and understanding of Perthes disease in a better way. So Mandar has a fantastic case. And let's see how he has managed that case. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you, sir. So this was again an older child, a 12-year-old male child, came with history of limping gait since 8 months. He's unable to sit cross-legged. He has significant issues with activities of daily living, and he has been unable to sit cross-legged since almost 3 years. So it's a long-standing history. And on examination, he has a flexion deformity of about 20 degrees. Further flexion is okay, but he has a fixed adduction and an external rotation deformity. So that is what is really troubling him. He's unable to sit down, he's unable to squat, he's unable to sit cross-legged. And this is the X-ray. So unfortunately, I could not upload the CT, but you can see that there is a severe coxa magna. And in this case, what is the difference between this and the previous case? That there is not much of this sagging rope sign which is seen. But what is seen is that there is this significant central necrosis. So that is this area which is the problem area. So should I go ahead or Taral sir?
Yeah. We have overshot the time. So just show what you have done.
So what I did was through the surgical dislocation approach, I did a femoral head reduction osteotomy. And what happens is that once we reduce the femoral head, the acetabulum then start seeming dysplastic. So we always have to do some procedure for the acetabulum, preferably a Degas, through the same approach. So this was what was done. You can see that there is severe femoral head necrosis deformity with a central necrosis. So this sort of wedge was removed. You can see this. So this wedge was removed, and after that there was fairly good cartilage, and after which I could fix it with Herbert screws. So I put 3 Herbert screws for this, distalize the trochanter. So it is always important to put this screw so that this remaining head neck region doesn't fracture. So this is a stabilizing screw, and along with that 3 screws and the trochanteric fixation. So this is the immediate post-op X-ray. You can see that there is good congruency, and there is a acetabulum also is congruent because of the Degas which has been done. And this is 6 months post-op. He is improving in his range. He still has a slightly restricted internal rotation. He is able to sit cross-legged and just about able to squat. So he's improving in his range. I hope that he was coming in the last month or so, but because of COVID, he was unable to come as follow-up. So this is what is described as by Gans as the femoral head reduction osteotomy. And by Dror Pelle, which he has elaborated it quite well in his article.
Absolutely. So, you know, when the Perthes is healed and has a lot of sequelae, which Sandeep has very nicely classified, problems of angulation, problems of femoral head size, problems of femoral head shape, problems of trochanter, you have to individualize the treatment. And here, because the problem was in the femoral head shape and the size, Andar very well chose to actually go down and correct what was wrong. And at the same time, because acetabulum was secondarily dysplastic to accommodate the large head, now we have decreased the size of the head, you have to reduce the size of the acetabulum by doing Degas. But again, this is one of a case, this is something which is not common. And I just want to tell you that this is a very specialized procedure and should be referred to specialized centers and specialized people.
Absolutely. So
we've overshot the time by 4 minutes for the Perthes session. So we will end here. And now I invite Dr. Ashish Ranade. The second session is going to be on DDH.
I want to ask one question.
Yeah, please ask questions.
Whenever we did the BDRO surgery, whether the implant is to remove or to kill, or if we want to remove, when one should remove?
Okay. So, Swapnil, you want to answer that question?
Yeah. If you're so, doing varus. The plate can definitely be removed early once the osteotomy heals, because you don't really need to keep it. There is definitely some remodeling which will take place, but that won't change whether the plate is there or not. So once the osteotomy has healed, maybe 1.5-2 years, totally consolidated, bone is looking good. Certainly you can definitely remove it. And your trochanteric epiphyseodesis obviously works on the principle of drilling the trochanter and putting the screw. So by that time, I think your trochanteric epiphyseodesis has also been taken care of.
Absolutely.
But what was my observation? Once we remove the plate, again remodeling of the head neck occurs. And if you keep the implant, it will remain as it is. This is my personal opinion.
Sir, absolutely. Sir, my observation, as you rightly said, is that we require the plate for the fragmentation and the early reossification phase. So I look at the X-ray and look at whether it has passed the early reossification phase and only then remove the implant. So probably if you look at the timeline of Perthes, about 1.5 years is what is the usual timeline for a removal of plate. But that all depends on the stage of Perthes.
So I agree. The implant should be removed. So generally it's 9 or 10 years when we do the surgery. The plate should be removed when the child is 12, 13, because by that time everything else is mature. And that gives you an opportunity, if you are removing the plate, if any additional surgery is required. Suppose you need to do a bunk peptomy, or if you want to do trochanteric transfer, or if there is excessive varus and you want to correct it, it gives you a window to correct all these things at the same time. So one should not be in too much hurry to remove the plate. So Ashish, any other questions from the audience? Is there any other questions from...
And I think we'll go ahead.
We go ahead, yeah. So Ashish, please share your screen. We want to hear you talking about DDH. DDH is a big problem. And I want to say that Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India, which is led by Sandeep. Sandeep is the secretary of POSSI. And there is a very big moment to carry out a hip surveillance program for early detection of DDH in our country. So there is a panel which is having meetings nowadays to see how we can prevent late detection and late treatment of DDH. Okay, so the first step of early treatment is early detection, and we are very keen to listen to Ashish Ranade about how to detect DDH early and how to treat early in a pre-walking age. Ashish, please go ahead.
Good evening. Thank you, Taral. Thank you, Shinde sir, Karne sir, and Moe. I'm going to talk about management in the pre-walking age. So briefly, we will be seeing how to diagnose, what investigations to do, and basically how to treat it in a child less than 1 year of age. So it's a spectrum from dysplasia to true dislocation, and there could be variations in between, such as subluxation, and this does not include teratological, syndromic, or neuromuscular dislocations. As you can see, that the one above is a frank dislocation and the one on the lower, it shows some dysplasia. So in brief, pathoanatomy, it includes both intra-articular as well as extra-articular structures. So all these obstacles, they have bearing on the treatment. So they should be considered while treating a child with DDH. So as we all know, ileocervus contracture, the contracture of the capsule and redundant capsule. Then intra-articularly, there will be fibrofatty pulvinar, the enlarged thickened ligamentum teres, and contracted transverse acetabular ligament. So to diagnose clinically in a child less than 6 months of age, one will see that there will be asymmetrical thigh folds. There will be limb length difference, which could be because of number of reasons, and there will be asymmetrical abduction. In a younger child, the Barlow and Ortolani test, they are useful. But as you can see in the graph, as the child grows, the instability, which are detected by the Barlow and Ortolani test, the instability reduces, and approximately after 2 or 3 months of age, limited abduction and other signs, they become important. So in a neonate, the Barlow test and the Ortolani test, they're important to diagnose the DDH, but not in an older child, not So a child, say, more than 2 months of age. So again, I reiterate the importance of watching for asymmetrical thigh folds, limb length discrepancy as seen in this picture, and asymmetrical abduction. So what needs to be done? We also get walking edge dislocations. Mandar is going to talk about that, and they have asymmetrical abduction, painless limb, and hyperlordosis if it is bilateral. So usually the modality of investigation is ultrasound in a child younger than 4 or 6 months before the ossified nucleus appears, and static imaging, the graph method, is used. In India, we are not following universal screening. There is a lot of controversy about screening methods, whether to do it universal screening or whether to follow focus screening. But usually the indications are, if the clinical examination is not very sure, or maybe follow-up of a child in Pavlik harness, and selective screening. So by selective screening, I mean that if we are seeing a child who is born of breech presentation, then the child has increased risk by 5 times. There is a positive family history, which increases the risk. Then there is associated foot deformity, such as calcaneovalgus, metatarsus adductus, or if it is associated with a congenital knee dislocation. So all these children should undergo ultrasound evaluation. The timing is important. They need not have ultrasound investigation immediately, because the false positive rates are very high if this examination is done, say, at 2 or 3 weeks of age, because there will be some laxity which resolves with time. And typically these screening ultrasounds, they are done after 5th or 6th week of life. And so that's the graph classification, and it measures two angles, the alpha and beta. And normally this alpha angle should be more than 60 degrees and the beta angle should be less than 55 degrees. And there are 4 types according to graph classification. X-ray pelvis with both hips, AP view, is typically useful after the child has reached 4 months of age, because the ossific nucleus typically appears after 4th month. But in some children, it may take longer. And in this, we look at various lines, such as the Hilgen-Reiner's line, the Perkins line, the Shenton's line. And in slightly older children, we look at the acetabular index and the center edge angle, which is more than, which is useful in a child more than 6 years of age. So based on this plain AP radiographs, there is a International Hip Dysplasia Institute classification, which looks at the position of this point, the midpoint of the metafacial part. So this classification focuses on the position of the metaphysis of the proximal femur and where it lies in relationship to this line. So this is grade 1, where it is medial. Grade 2, it is on the lateral side, but it is inferior to this diagonal line. If it is above, that's grade 3. And high riding, that's grade 4. So it's somewhat similar to the Tonis classification. Arthrogram, it's done typically during OR, during treatment part. Routine use of arthrogram for diagnosing is not necessary. So treatment principles, we want to achieve concentric reduction without excessive force. We want to maintain that reduction for a specified time with hip spica and maybe followed by a hip abduction splint. And we want to promote normal growth of the acetabulum and femoral head. And of course, lastly, we want to minimize the complications. So treatment of choice from neonate to 6-month-old child is a Pavlik harness. So this is a flexion abduction orthosis, which maintains hip in flexion and abduction. And typically one should achieve about 100 degrees of flexion and 50 degrees of abduction. There is a lot of controversy about what protocol to use, how long one should use it, whether one should do it ultrasonography while in harness or not. I typically use it for minimum of 3 months and then start weaning it, start using it during nighttime use. And I usually do 1 ultrasound check while there in the harness. So pretty we don't start very early because of false positive results. And there is no role of double diaper modality, which was once thought to be of useful to maintain the hips in abduction. So results with Pavlik harness are pretty predictable. We do not get to see many patients where Pavlik harness can be applied. We tend to get to see them at a later stage. 90% success rate, it avoids all the big surgeries, but it can fail for older children bilateral if the hip is not reducible, which is negative ortolani. And the complications are less: femoral nerve palsy, which is of hyperflexion, and neurovascular necrosis, which is because of hyperabduction. So what is the treatment for a child who is more than 6 months? Why 6 months? Because when that usually typically that point, the child starts crawling and it's not possible to keep the child in Pavlik harness. So in a child older than 6 months, but maybe up to 1 year, and someone who has failed harness, the treatment of choice is close reduction under anesthesia with arthrogram, if required, adductor tenotomy and hip spica cast for about 3 months, followed by abduction splint. The success rate is 80 to 90%. One should achieve concentric stable reduction. We'll talk about that. What does that mean? Younger the child, better the results. And remember, the acetabulum can remodel up to 4 years of age. The complications are mainly a vascular necrosis and redislocation. In a recent study, a prospective multicenter study, it was found that the chances of redislocation are about 10%. But the risk of a vascular necrosis was 25%. So quite high, 25%. But usually they do well if treated with close reduction. Is there any role of traction? It has been debated. A recent study out of China showed that it really doesn't give any positive results. But in India, none of us are following traction. But recently in POSI, we had a webinar where excellent results were shown by a Japanese orthopedic surgeon. So arthrogram, once the reduction is achieved, arthrogram is done. That is to evaluate the anatomy of the hip. Swapnil has demonstrated excellent arthrogram. In DDH, typically we do a subadductor approach on the medial side. And I use Omnipec 1:3 dilution. And then we look at the various soft tissue impediments which may hamper the reduction, such as the inverted labrum, the transverse acetabular ligament, the hypertrophied pulmonar ligamentum teres, the tight anterior joint capsule. So how do we reduce? How do we assess whether the reduction is stable or not? We look for something called safe zone of Ramsey, which means if we abduct more, the hip becomes stable, but the chances of avascular necrosis, they're increased. And if we adduct, then the chances of redislocation are high. Someone has described a hip instability state, a test in which the hip is reduced and then a pressure is given from the anterior aspect. If this pushes back the hip into posterior direction, if the hip dislocates with this, they call it positive test and they recommend adding a K wire to this. So this is the arc, what we are talking about, the safe zone. The chances of redislocation are high if it is adducted, and the chances of AVN are high if it is in too much of abduction. So somewhere around 50 degrees should be ideal. If it is too narrow, one should do adductor tenotomy. That increases the abduction without putting excessive pressure on the femoral head. So at that point, we typically do arthrogram and carry out hip through various movements. Here you can see that this is in neutral position. This is in adduction. And while doing that, I also give posteriorly directed pressure to see whether the hip is coming out or not. And that's the position in abduction. And that's the position in flexion abduction. So based on this, we decide whether to put a cast or how is the quality of reduction at that point. So good reduction should have intact Shenton's line. There should be less than 2 millimeter discrepancy. This dye pool should be less. Here it is more, it's more than 6 millimeters, which means that there is something inside the capsule which is lateralizing the femoral head, and the metaphysis should direct towards the triradiate cartilage in the abduction film, as you can see in this picture. It is directing over there. So that's a 11-month-old girl. She was treated with close reduction, and that's the arthrogram intraoperatively, and she was put in a hip splinter cast. So what do we do if the close reduction is failed? Well, then there are options of open reduction. There is debate about the timing, whether one should wait till the appearance of till the ossific nucleus appears, because that has bearing on the rate of vascular necrosis and dislocation. But I'm not going into details of that. Mandar will talk about that. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ashish, for that comprehensive coverage of a young child with DDH. I think we'll finish the lecture by Mandar before we move to cases by which Taral will conduct again. So Mandar, can you go ahead with your management of DDH in walking age?
Yes, sir. Just one second. It's just sitting up.
So I just, till the time he sets up, I want to ask one question again. Sandeep, you can also answer that. Sure. So generally the approach is divided by walking versus non-walking. But actually we see a lot of children who are beyond walking age, we can get a close reduction. A lot of children who are below walking age, you cannot get a close reduction. So is it good to classify the children into non-walking and walking age group? So I want to ask Ashish first and then Mandar. You know, is this division all right, or should we classify them into, you know, amenable to close treatment and open treatment? Ashish, you can answer.
I agree. That's very true, that sometimes the young child reduction is not possible, and in an older child. So unfortunately, none of these classifications, they take into consideration the ease of reduction, the laxity. So I completely agree with you that it's not the age.
Mandar, you can answer this and then continue with your
presentation. Yes, sir. Absolutely, I agree with you, sir. Because most of the time, say if it's a 9-10 month old child also whom I am going to take for close reduction, I am going to tell the parents that 95% of the times I should be able to get a close reduction, but I am going to be prepared for a small open reduction if required. So it's not assured that if it's a pre-walking age or if it's less than 18 months and we are going to definitely get a good stable close reduction. What is very important is to have a good stable close reduction at the end of your procedure. Should I go ahead, sir?
Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. So thank you, Ashish, for this excellent comprehensive talk. So just to cover up what he has said, as he said, is the commonest pediatric hip disorder, and there is a spectrum of dysplasia, subluxation, and dislocation. And there are these various risk factors of female child breech and the firstborn child. And as he said, treatment since 1 to 6 months is the Pavlik harness. And from 6 to 18 months, we should attempt a close reduction in the form of an adductor tenotomy, an arthrogram, and a hip spica. So what happens when the DDH remains untreated? There are various changes which happen. The head starts becoming more and more proximally dislocated. There are various changes which happen inside the hip capsule. There is an Argyrus constriction of the capsule, which is because of the psoas tendon. The femoral capital epiphysis, there is a delayed ossification. There is increased antiversion of the femoral neck shaft. And in the acetabulum, it becomes extremely deficient and deficient anterolaterally. In clinical features, you have this classic child. If it's a unilateral child, it's relatively easy to diagnose. You can see that there is a significant Trendelenburg lurch, which the child presents with. The entire pelvis is sagging. There is typical excessive lumbar lordosis, which is seen. And restricted abduction is the very characteristic feature in an untreated DDH. So it's always important for any PG or student it is always important to not say Barlow-Ortolani test when the child is more than, say, 4 to 5 months or so. It's always going to be negative. So the classic sign is a restricted abduction. The Galeazzi sign is positive. That is, if you flex both the hip and knee, you will see that there is a difference in the levels of the knees. And there is asymmetric gluteal folds as seen here. Telescopy test is one thing which should be done. I was lucky to have a very cooperative child here. Usually the kids usually start howling. But you can see that there is this classic pistoning, which is seen when the femoral head is not in the acetabulum. X-rays are quite specific. You can see if you draw the Perkins and the Hilgen-Rainer's line, the capital femoral epiphysis is in the superolateral quadrant. The Shenton's line is broken. If you can draw the acetabular index, usually after about 2 to 3 years or so, the acetabular index should be about 20 degrees, which is there on this side. Here it's almost 45 degrees. So usually 30 and above is what is abnormal. You can see that there is widening of the Kohler's tear drop. This is normal, and there is a widened Kohler's tear drop here. And if you look at the lateral view, you can see that there is increased antiversion of the proximal femur. Along with that, if you see this margin, you can see that this is the unossified portion, and you can see that there is a depression which happens in the superolateral acetabular region, and that is the false acetabulum which starts forming. Why do we treat an untreated DDH? If it is unilateral, there is significant issues of limb length discrepancy and future pain in the adjacent joints, the knee, the opposite hip and the spine. And in bilateral, there is significant gait issues and there will be future pain, especially if the false acetabulum is formed and in young adulthood. So what are the various treatment options? The treatment options, we can attempt a close reduction and a spica. I'm going to come to that. Is there a role of a gradual close reduction with traction? Or what is the role of open reduction and further procedures? Can we attempt close reduction and hip spica in an 18-month-old? Well, we can attempt anything, but mostly it is not successful. It usually is a very unstable reduction with a very narrow safe zone. And while in high riding dislocation, the femur is just not unable to be brought back to the acetabulum. So you can see this. This is a intra-op picture. You can see that the femoral head is going in the acetabulum, but it's a very narrow safe zone and it's just popping out easily. And if you see the arthrogram also, if you can see this arthrogram, there is a big medial dipole. There is a large ligamentum teres, which is very beautifully seen. And it's a very narrow safe zone which we are getting. So this unstable close reduction should never be accepted in a walking age child. Is there a role for gradual traction and close reduction? Well, to be frank, I thought that this is currently not acceptable. But this is an article which I read. And then we saw the fantastic webinar, which was done through POSI, where the Japanese group, they do this gradual traction with close reduction. It's a gradual traction in various ways, which they do over 8 to 10 weeks. So initially, they do horizontal traction like this, after which vertical traction, and then above knee traction, which is given. They give it for almost 6 to 10 weeks, and they have excellent results in their hand with magically no AVN. However, this has not been replicated in other centers. So the treatment of choice remains open reduction. However, it's not only open reduction. What is important is that open reduction, if required, you should do a femoral osteotomy. And if required, you do a pelvic procedure. What does that mean? It means that you should make the hip stable on table by whatever means. I'm going to come to various stages as we go ahead. What are the approaches for open reduction? There are three main approaches. One is the medial approach. The commonest medial approach is the Ludloff's approach. The anteromedial approach, a not very commonly used approach, is the Ponseti and Weinstein's approach. And the commonest one used is the Somerville approach. We are going to deal in detail with the Somerville approach. Just a few words about the medial approach. It is a popular approach in some centers. It's used mostly before 18 months of age. The approach is between the adductor longus and brevis. You can do a psoas sternotomy at the LT. However, there is a significant danger of damage to the medial circumflex femoral artery with a theoretically high chance of avascular necrosis. Let's come to open reduction. what exactly is meant by open reduction? Well, open reduction means nothing but removal of whatever barriers to reduction are there. So they can be extra-articular or intra-articular. In extra-articular barriers to reduction, the commonest are the adductors, sartorius, tensor fasciae, rectus, and psoas. While the intra-articular barriers to reduction are the ligamentum teres, the pulvinar, the capsular constriction, inverted labrum, and the transverse acetabular ligament. So we are going to come to that in a bit. What are the indications? Well, as Ashish said, we should not accept an unstable close reduction, even if the age is less than 18 months. So whatever you want to do, you want to make a hip stable on table. In arthrogryposis, probably there should be a very low level, low threshold for open reduction. Usually it requires open reduction. The procedure, this is the way I do it. This is the position of the child. It's a folded sheet under the ipsilateral LS spine with a sandbag near the opposite hip. It's almost like a semilateral position. The incision is an anterior bikini incision, which is centered over the anterior inferior iliac spine. So this is the anterior superior iliac spine. It is about a centimeter below the ASIS. It is centered over it. It's usually the Smith-Peterson interval which is used. The first muscle which is identified and released is the sartorius. Then the rectus below it, it's usually the straight head of the rectus which is released. Some people tag it. I usually don't tag it. I just release it after taking it with the mixture. And the third muscle which is released is the psoas tendon. The next important step is the splitting of the crest. Here the crest, iliac crest, is completely split, because of which we are able to completely release the abductors from the crest, so that you can reach the capsule by releasing the abductor. So this is the abductor capsule interval which we enter, because of which you will be able to see this nice capsule after we have released the abductors from the iliac crest. A T-shaped capsulotomy is performed after taking these tag sutures, which help in further capsulorrhaphy. And once you do a good capsulotomy, you will be able to see the femoral head with the big, large, hypertrophied ligamentum teres. Now, this usually we get, but in some old dislocations, because of the prolonged walking, this does get atrophied and we may not be able to find it. If it is found, then it usually leads us to the true acetabulum, which is very important to see. It is cut at both ends. The fibrofatty tissue which is present, which is the pulvinar, is removed by a scoop, after which you should be able to see the acetabulum in all 360 degrees like this. Once reduction is obtained, then what? Usually you should be able to get a good close reduction once you have done all this removal of barriers which are extra-articular as well as intra-articular. Then this is a very good review by Zade et al. From Stanmore about test of stability as an aid to decide the osteotomy. So what does that mean? It means that you decide by the position in which you get the reduction. So if you get a reduction in neutral rotation and abduction, you can accept this and give a spica in human position. If you are getting the reduction in deep internal rotation, it means that you require to derotate the distal fragment, thus by doing a derotation osteotomy. If you are getting a reduction in wide abduction and internal rotation, it means that you require a varus as well as derotation. So you do a conventional varus derotation osteotomy. While if the hip is unstable in extension and adduction, it means that you require some amount of anterolateral coverage which is deficient, and you have to do some form of pelvic procedure on an acetabuloplasty. Then you go to the lateral side, you expose the proximal femur. I usually like to use a 5-hole recon plate or a DCP for a slightly older child. I usually pre-drill one screw in the proximal fragment so that gives us a hold, as well as put a small wire through the proximal fragment so as to hold it. And this is then transfixed temporarily so as to help in derotating the distal fragment. So you can see these derotation marks. So these are marks which are made, and an osteotomy is made in between. So this is the screw hole. An osteotomy is made in between, and then this distal fragment is derotated so as to then apply the plate in this manner. After the plating, after the varus osteotomy, you should get a hip which is absolutely stable. So you can see this intraop picture and see in whatever position is there, the hip should remain stable. Your stability should be so foolproof that the hip should remain stable in whatever position the hip is moving. There are various means to measure antiversion. There is a very complex article by Sankar et al. About femoral antiversion in developmental dysplasia of the hip, where he has given a very big trigonometric rule. However, what is easy and logical to do is basically match the version of the proximal fragment and the distal fragment by putting two wires or a derotation wire, and then match it in this manner. When is shortening required? Well, if the reduction is extremely tight or you are unable to obtain a reduction, then a shortening is required. Whatever fragments are overlapped, you just remove that wedge and then fix it with a plate. Capsulorraphy is extremely important. It is the utilization of the redundant capsule in order to improve the stability of the hip. Here, what you have to do is double breast the capsule by something known as a shirt in pant closure. As you can see, these are the tag sutures which we have taken. So this point is sutured to the most medial point with this tag suture, and this point is then sutured across like this, so that then you have a very tight capsular closure in this manner. You give a 1.5 hip spica, which is usually given in about 30 degrees of flexion, 30 degrees of abduction, and neutral rotation. The post-operative protocol is the first cast is at 4 weeks. Usually we remove the wire at around 4 weeks. We change the spica at 4 weeks and keep the spica for about 8 weeks. After which I use a brace, which is a posterior spica shell, which is gradually weaned off over the next 3 months. What happens when you get a deficient anterolateral coverage? What are these pelvic osteotomies? Just a brief overview of these pelvic osteotomies. So there are pelvic procedures for congruous joints, which are divided into pelvic osteotomies, which are complete osteotomies, which classically are the innominate, which is the Salters, double innominate, there is Sutherland's, and the triple innominate, and the acetabuloplasties, which is Pemberton, Dega, and the San Diego. We are just going to briefly cover them. So the pelvic osteotomies are redirecting osteotomies. They don't do anything to the volume of the hip joint, while the acetabuloplasties are the restructuring osteotomies. These are the incongruous joints. Just briefly, Salters is basically a complete osteotomy where you take a wedge from the anterior superior iliac spine and put it in it like this and fix it with wires. It is a technically less demanding, but it's relatively unstable and requires internal fixation. This is a double innominate osteotomy and a triple innominate osteotomy. Again, very complex osteotomy, which is used for older dysplasias. What do you mean by acetabuloplasties? There are various acetabuloplasties, which are basically bending procedures. Pemberton was initially used quite commonly. It hinges at the triradiate. However, what is important is the Degas osteotomy, which I commonly do. This is a very rare photo which was given to me by Dr. Taral sir. Here, it's an incomplete osteotomy, which starts just at the level of the anterior inferior iliac spine and is directed posteriorly. It is hinged at the level of the triradiate and it is brought down. So the acetabular index, which is vertical, is then brought down and tricortical grafts are placed here. You can see this is the osteotome and which is then brought down in this manner. After which, again, you should get a stable hip. You can see that this hip is being ranged intraop, a Dega acetabuloplasty. This is a wedge which has been put. As you can see, in all rotations and even in full adduction, it is not dislocating. So you should get a hip which is stable in this manner. Only then do I leave the OT. I always put a transarticular wire only for about 4 weeks. Just this is for my peace of mind. There's no specific scientific reason for this, but this helps in keeping the hip stable. Lastly, about the San Diego osteotomy, this is a complete cut, but it does not cut the medial edge of the pelvis. And again, triangular bone grafts are put. What are the complications of open reduction? There is redislocation, avascular necrosis, and stiffness. This is a fantastic article by Pablo Castaneda, almost 700 hips, where he has said that it is about 5 to 6% across all series, but it decreases to only about 2% when pelvic osteotomy is added. Sorry. The common issues are incomplete soft tissue clearance, virgin issues, and undercorrection of the acetabular index. Avascular necrosis is a dreaded complication which many a time we can't do anything for it. There are two basic classifications, the Kalamchi and McEwan classification and the Buchholz classification. However, what is important to know is the most important sign is that it should be a smaller ossific nucleus after about 1 year. Only then you diagnose it as avascular necrosis. How old is too old for reduction and reconstruction? In bilateral, the usual thing is about 8 years. In unilateral, it's about 11 years. And there is increased chance of stiffness with increasing age. Thus, take-home messages about walking age DDH. It's a difficult problem requiring complex reconstruction. Good open reduction is the key to a good result. Once you do open reduction, you check the virgin and add abduction. Then, if required, do a varus derotation osteotomy. Check stability in adduction and extension. If it is dislocating, add an anterolateral coverage by an acetabuloplasty. Thus, the key here is achieve a stable hip on table by whichever means. Thank you very much.
Nice, Mandar. Very, very comprehensive coverage of a very difficult problem. So, you know, what I understand as a summary is that if you achieve a stable hip, well-covered hip, a hip which is, and if you achieve it safely, then whether the child is below walking age or above walking age, whether it's a closed reduction or open reduction, still you are on a safe wicket. Yeah. Any questions from the panel on DDH? Any discussion which can generate? So I want to ask a question to Mandar that if you have a child who is 18 months and on table, you feel that you are able to get a closed reduction, whether you will proceed with closed reduction or still do an open reduction with a stabilizing procedure at that age group. What is your choice?
Sir, if I get a good closed reduction with a good safe zone, I'll accept it. So as you said, just as there is no younger age for an open reduction, there is also no older age for a closed reduction. Whatever procedure makes the hip stable is what is required. So if I'm getting a closed reduction at 18 months with a good safe zone without excessive force, I'll still accept it. Though I'll confirm it with a arthrogram and see that there's no medial dipole.
So stability with safety, that's your motto, right?
Absolutely. Okay.
I want to ask a question to Ashish that you have a child who is, say...
Ashish is gone. He has gone. Some emergency.
No problem. Sandeep, you can answer that. Suppose, Sandeep, there is a child, 8-month-old, I've taken for close reduction. I get a close reduction, but it is stable in extreme abduction. Now, what should I do? Should I
extreme abduction, if you are able to get, have you done an adductor tenotomy?
No, everything is done, but you know, moment you adduct to almost 60 degree abduction, it just slips away.
Yeah,
so what are your options after that? You know, what should you do? You know, suppose this patient is again in a, say, Yavatmal or Amravati, and somebody is doing a close reduction, gets a close reduction, but it's in extreme abduction. What should the surgeon actually do on table? What should be the next step?
Arthrogram, because extreme abduction, if you are needing, one is AVN chances are very high. Redislocation also is very high.
Right.
And probably the click that you felt is not really a click of reduction. You have to document it with an arthrogram or some form of a limited procedure.
On arthrogram, it is getting reduced. Very well reduced, yeah. But in extreme abduction, not in, say, safe zone as we described. What we do
so
next?
Extreme? No, you do an open reduction.
Open reduction. All right. Okay.
There is one question coming from Rajiv Niravne.
Right.
Asking this question is to Mandar and other faculty. When you get a patient with a unilateral DDH at 12 to 14 months of age with a high acetabular index, will you prefer to delay the procedure to 18 months in anticipation of an acetabular procedure, or whether you would do it then and there?
So an acetabular index which is seen on a plain X-ray is many a times misleading. Many a times it is an unossified lateral wall which is seen on table rather than on the X-ray. So whatever it is on table decision. Even if it's a 13, 14 month old child, I'll still, if required, do a pelvic procedure. but it's extremely unlikely that I'll require to do a pelvic procedure because most of the time it's quite a snug fit at that age. What I do is usually put some small periosteum just above the femoral head in order to know whether there is any great space between the femoral head and the acetabulum. So if usually you don't get that much of space and it's not required. But if required at around 13 months, I don't mind doing it. Again, very unlikely.
I agree with Mandar on that because I've always been saying that the cartilaginous roof is not seen on a plain X-ray. So the acetabular index that you say or calculate is highly erroneous unless you do an arthrographic cartilaginous acetabular index, which will give you a true. Once the head is in a younger child less than 2, 2.5, I think it will ossify, and we have seen that happen quite often. Secondly, in the enthusiasm to do an acetabular procedure with such a soft bone in such a young age, we are more likely to do more harm to the roof than any good. That is my personal opinion, though people may have their own opinion.
No, I agree to that. That, you know, just because you see an acetabulum where acetabular index is high, it doesn't mean that you have to do a Degas procedure. Yeah. What you see on X-ray can be misleading, and you should finally decide on table by doing an arthrogram. Now, if there is a hip which you have treated by close reduction or by ultrasound and then Pauli harness, and later on you see that one side there is acetabulum is looking dysplastic, what is the currently people do is then do an MRI, because you don't want to do an arthrogram. Do an MRI and look at cartilaginous acetabular index, and it has been proven that if that is good, that acetabulum will ossify over
period. You wait. So what I feel is, now when the people look at DDH, they have to understand that there are two different concepts. One is dislocation, second is dysplasia. Okay, if you can do reduction of the dislocation and make it stable, the dysplasia will remodel. If the child is less than 2 years or 3 years old, I would extend it to 2.5 or 3. You don't try to treat the dysplasia if your reduction is stable, is my philosophy.
Can we go to cases now? I would ask Tanvi to share screen and present the first case of a DDH. And this will be followed by Dr. Sandeep Patwardhan presenting a case of osteochondroma hip, and then Rajiv Negandhi presenting a case of PFFD. So we are going from easy to difficult. And we are trying to include some more hip problems which are neither Perthes or DDH. Yeah, Tanvi, please proceed.
So I would like to thank Maharashtra Orthopedic Association and organizers of today's webinar for giving me this opportunity to present amongst all the stalwarts. So this is a case of DDH. A 18-year-old girl child presented with a limping gait. The Trendelenburg test and telescopy test was positive. Abduction on the left side was limited, and she also had 1 centimeter of supratrochanteric shortening. So you can see in the X-ray, the Shenton lines is broken. The capital epiphyseal dysplasia is also seen. The widening of the joint space and a slightly superior migration of the femoral head is also seen. The acetabulum is shallow with a high acetabular index. So MRI was done, and it again showed a lateral subluxation with a shallow acetabulum. This was the gait of the child. As you can see, there is an asymmetric fold on the thigh can also be seen, and the gait is a Trendelenburg type gait with a drop of pelvis. So at the 18 month age, we had the options of, as Mandar sir had said, arthrogram with close reduction and SOS open reduction. And we offered the same to the child. But the parents had some personal issues, and they opted for a time, but presented after age of 3 years. So at the age of 3 years, the child had actually a good contained head, but a shallow acetabulum with high acetabular index. The Shenton lines appears to be intact. But still, she had a limping gait. Trendelenburg was positive, but the telescopy was negative. So if you draw Mohs's circle on the left side, it appears to be like this. It's not concentric as seen on the right side. So as just discussed by Taral sir, this is a case of acetabular dysplasia with minimal subluxation. So sir, I would like to ask, should we wait for the acetabulum to remodel or we proceed with the surgery?
Mandar, you want to answer that first?
So it's very, very surprising result from about a year and a half from the first to the second x-ray. So I will probably, looking at the way this hip has improved over the 1.5 years, I'll probably wait on and see what happens after a year or so and check it out.
Sandeep?
Can you go back to the
anyone?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, primarily also when you see the first x-ray, there has hardly been any sort of overriding. So it was at that same level. So this is more of a dysplasia and the dysplasia variety. So it's a mild to moderate DDH. It's not a completely dislocated hip. So probably the outcome will be better. Of course, here at some point, some procedure may be needed for the acetabulum only. Otherwise, everything else looks fine. But right now, probably as Bandar said, we would observe.
Yeah, treat the acetabular dysplasia at an older age when you have better bone stock if it is symptomatic.
So, going to the literature, I found that there is high chances of osteoarthritis in acetabular dysplasia, especially when the CE angle is less than 20. And in this case, the CE angle was about 18 degrees. And on this side, it was almost 30 degrees. So we went ahead and did a Degas procedure for this child. And this was a 3-month post-op x-ray when the CE angle is restored to 25 degrees. The acetabular index has come down to 18 degrees. And this is a 9-year post-op x-rays with a good remodeling of the acetabulum and a good clinical outcome.
Very nice.
The child is currently symptom-free. Thank you.
So usually we tend to do this more in residual dysplasia after primary surgery, where only a open reduction has been done. That is where we probably tend to do second-stage acetabular procedure. So this is probably one of those rare cases where it was a mild dysplasia and has done very, very well with the Dega.
So I just want to share the case which I'm not presenting today because of lack of time. We have one such patient which has been, we have 12-year follow-up. So a child with close reduction had a acetabular dysplasia. And then we waited and waited and waited because the we initially waited, did MRI, it was not convincing. At 5 years age, I felt surgery should be done. Parents did not agree and did not agree. So I have serial x-rays of this child at the age of 1 year, 3 years, 5 years, 7 years, 9 years. At 11 years, this girl had pain. She was a MP state level 100 meter runner, champion, state champion, participating at the national level running programs. Then she started having pain, and then we realized that she had dysplasia, which progressed to that such a level that now she started getting pain. And at age of 13 years, we did a femoral osteotomy as well as acetabular procedure. We had to be very careful in her because she's high level athlete, and we could not have decrease in gluteal power. So, the surgery was planned, it was done and executed well. And within 1 year, she could go back to sports and she doesn't have pain and she's back to national level playing now. So what Tanvi has presented has a very important message that after close reduction, you should continue to follow up the child, continue to take x-rays. And Mandar, I want to ask a question, how frequently you should follow up these children? Should you take x-ray every 6 months or a year or, till what age would you follow up this child?
So, when I start off with a DDH, I always tell the parents that I would like to see them at least till skeletal maturity. Mm-hmm. So if I tell them that I would like to see them at skeletal maturity, till skeletal, I I think that they will at least come till 8-9 years of age.
Okay.
Considering the follow-up which we have. Mm-hmm. Initially, probably 6-monthly, and then every yearly x-rays is what I suggest.
Okay. And Sandeep, what is your upper limit? By what age the acetabulum should be put back into its shape? You know, beyond you
will... In the sense, surgically?
Surgically. So if there is a residual acetabular dysplasia, by what age it should be 100% operated?
No, so there are a couple of things here. One is that if the child is less than 2.5, I don't do a primary acetabular surgery.
Right.
And if in the next 3 or 4 years, I see that there is no change in the acetabulum or acidification is poor, then I will label it as residual acetabular dysplasia and warn the family.
Yeah. So by 6 years to decide. By 6 years, if it's still poor.
Three years after my primary surgery, at least, I should see improvement in the acetabular ossification. 2 to 3 years, progressively, it should look deeper and better.
Okay.
If it is not happening, then I would tell them that you might need additional surgery if symptomatic towards adolescence.
Excellent.
I've always found that if it is 10 plus, it's easier to handle bone and fix it because you can make the cuts more genuinely.
Right.
So you treat dysplasia at that age.
Yeah, Tanvi, you wanted to ask something.
Is there any role of Sjögren classification for residual dysplasia for indication for second procedure?
Sjögren is a hip dislocation classification, if I remember rightly.
Reduction hip dysplasia.
Right.
Okay.
You can use that. But basically, principally, there are two things, Tanvi, which are important. If the acetabular index is abnormal, but if Shenton line is restored, which means if the femoral head is in position, the mild dysplasias can be disregarded. Okay. So
but can be monitored.
But at the same time, if you had a similar radiological picture, if there is acetabular dysplasia along with disruption of the Shenton line, you will not disregard it. You have to treat. Secondly, you know, there is nothing wrong in waiting for a while. So there is no hurry to operate at 2 years, 3 years. You can easily wait up to 5 years age. And thirdly, whenever in doubt, you know, if you're not sure, if you do an MRI, of course, MRI in a child requires sedation or, you know, some sort of anesthesia. But if you can do MRI and prove that your cartilaginous sort of acetabulum is adequate, that sort of an unnecessary surgery if the cartilage is good can be prevented by doing
MRI. By far and large, they are asymptomatic. If they have symptoms, they will come to you.
I think I disagree here, Sandeep. By the time they develop symptom, it is very late. You know, so you want to treat so before that. Yeah, no, it has been written in literature. And everyone knows about
it. It's been written in literature.
Symptoms will come in second decade. They don't come in 5 and 6 years.
Yeah,
that doesn't mean that if there is a dysplasia, you should not treat early. You should treat early. You should not wait for symptom. But you must follow up the radiological changes very carefully. And that is what I follow at least. So let's go to the second case. Sandeep has a very interesting case of osteochondroma. Again, a very, very interesting issue.
I will just run through this case. We don't have too much time. Rajiv has an interesting case to present.
Please.
And we have, this is just a 14-year-old boy. In our country, people have this problem or obsession with sitting cross-legged. So he had painful terminal flexion and abduction extension rotation inability to squat. His plain x-ray showed this. So as you can see, this is a typical case of diaphyseal ecclesis. And a lot of diaphyseal ecclesis earlier, we tended to ignore or leave it alone when we treated only the forearms. And this was extra-articular impingement with a lot of extra-capsular and some intra-capsular osteochondromas, which were causing restriction of motion, as seen on MRI also. And eventually, GANS surgery, again, we have the GANS, which has given us an opening from where we can dislocate the hip and trim everything around the neck safely without causing osteonecrosis. So through the SSD approach, we took out all the big osteochondromas, big and small. And that was the complete clearance that I could achieve. And that was his post-operative x-ray and pre-op and post-op. So it went on to a very good restoration of his range of motion and pain has gone away. So just an extended indication, for doing a safe surgical dislocation and works quite well here. And again, a reminder of IFIX 2020. We have these fantastic speakers talking on pediatric trauma. So please register on ifix.in.
Thanks, Sandeep. So that is to show an extra articular problem also can give rise to hip dislocation. So we are looking at different causes of hip involvement in a child. And here it's important to realize that you can have osteochondroma in front, from back. And if it's back, it's more dangerous because that actually involves the area from which the blood supply of the femoral head comes. So blind excision of proximal femoral osteochondroma, especially if it's posterior, should not be done. You are on a tricky wicket. And Sandeep has shown us very well that looking at the blood supply, you know, seeing the femoral head 360 degrees and very carefully excising can lead to a safe relocation of the surgical of the head in a child, children with osteochondroma. Sandeep, one question is, as compared to, just taking an anterior incision and SSD in these scenarios, what is the difference? Because before this approach was known to us, we were doing it through other approaches. So do you find any difference in tackling such issues?
The intra-articular problems or specifically this particular case or any other?
This case, specifically such cases.
So what I feel is that earlier people weren't very aggressive also with removing these hip multiple tumors because we were not sure of completeness of our surgery. Right. So we went in anteriorly and did an incomplete job and said that that's about it. You can get. Mm-hmm. This has opened up a new kind of a approach or a vision to us that we can really do a complete clearance and that too safely.
Right. So here you don't have to actually dislocate the head.
Exactly. You subluxate it, you can look around, you can do a lot of stuff on the neck.
So it is safe surgical approach to the hip, rather than always calling it dislocation.
Dislocation.
So this is what sort of a message we want to give when we say SSD, it always means safe, but not necessarily does not mean always dislocation.
Yeah. And the second thing is safe is also very relative.
right.
I can show you enough unsafe dislocation.
So the only thing which is certain is surgical.
Yeah,
the safe surgical dislocation, it is surgical is safe.
Definitely there. And see, I think if you use it for the right indications, it really is a wonderful approach.
Okay, so let's go quickly to Rajiv's case. He has a case of a very interesting case of PFFD. Rajiv, please share your screen and what is your case? Tell us.
I want to thank Shinde sir for this case. This is his case. I am just presenting this case. This is a case which he had treated in 2011. This is a 14-year-old boy with a progressive shortening and difficulty in walking and functional inability of right lower limb. Apparently, his birth history was uneventful and there was no NICU admissions and stuff like that. On examination, his telescopy was negative, although Tendenbaum test was positive. He had a supratrochanteric shortening and overall shortening of 5 centimeters was there. This was his clinical picture. I don't have the details of his range of motion. And this is his Tendenbaum test positive. And this is how he was walking. Sorry for not very good x-ray video, but this is a 2011 video. Here you can see that he has a short limb gait, he has a Tendenbaum gait.
Yeah, Rajiv, you can go ahead.
Yeah. So, and these are his x-rays. So I would like to ask panel, what type of PFFD is this?
Saral, you want to comment?
I want to comment. So what I do is, of course, there are various classifications, Rajiv, and I am not very good at remembering.
Can you magnify that x-ray first? We are not able to see the head neck properly. If you just blow it up.
Yeah.
So I will just enumerate till the time Rajiv is magnifying and give us a better, clearer picture. What I want to say is there are various pathologies which are present here. There is a acetabulum, starting from there, acetabulum is dysplastic. There is a non-union of femoral neck. There is varus at the proximal femur.
Yeah.
And there is shortening. There is high-riding trochanter. So, you know, the good part is that acetabulum is developed well. The bad part is...
Looking at the quality of the head, you think this is PFMD or it's a post-septic sequelae, coxa vara?
This can be PFMD. This can be PFMD.
Yeah, look at the quality of his femur here. It seems to be normal size compared to opposite. PFMD, you don't get a normal development of the femur like this.
His thigh girth was also smaller as compared to
Will be there in infection, disuse, everything. Yeah. Here. But if you look at the shaft diameter bilaterally, this looks like a developed femur. The head looks developed compared to the size. It could be a post-septic sequelae or a fibrous kind of a... I don't know. I'm just thinking aloud. Taral, you can comment. Mandar, you can say something.
Yes, even if you look at the cortical diameter, it looks quite quite well formed. Anyway, so probably he must be having a severe adduction deformity, if I'm not mistaken.
I think whatever classifications we have seen or which are, I mean, like Palace classification, they are at very, very young age, like 1 year, 2 years of age. And they, I mean, there is nothing described probably in an adolescent with such kind of PFMD.
Yeah, but you agree that it is a congenital disorder?
I mean, looking at
PFMD,
the history,
PFMD is a congenital disorder, right?
Yeah.
So even at adolescent, there has to be hypoplasia of the hemipelvis and everything. It is not a focal thing.
Yeah.
I feel this is something else.
So if we just consider this as a palate type 2A, I mean, let it be a PFFD or a non-union. But as Taral sir said, there is a severe coxa vara. The tip of GT is at higher level. Head is not dislocated, but it is well centered, and there is a slightly hypoplastic right femoral shaft. So these are his MRI pictures. Anyone like to comment on this?
So what is the age of the child at present? Again,
14 years.
So one of the things I want to say is that if you are dealing with such a case, which is proximal focal femoral deficiency, nowadays we call it also as CFD, congenital femoral dysplasia. The whole idea, what we are seeing, you know, in all the hip disorders, Persis disease, DDH, PFFDs, earlier the better. So one doesn't have to wait, you know, till 14 years. One doesn't even have to wait till 6 years. One doesn't have to wait till 2 years for treating such children. See, to lengthen or not to lengthen is an option. It's not necessary that always you have to equalize limb length, but it is important to normalize the proximal femoral anatomy in these patients. Okay. So even if this child is going to walk with extension prosthesis, if you have given him a good femoral anatomy and good biomechanics of the hip, he's going to do better in a long run. And earlier done, this is better. And the treatment here is to restore the neck shaft angle, restore the continuity of the femoral neck by doing osteosynthesis of femoral neck. And when you're doing this, obviously you make the hip joint unstable. So you have to do a procedure to stabilize the hip joint by doing an acetabuloplasty. And when you're doing all this, you will also require a subtrochanteric osteotomy to correct the femoral varus. So these three procedures will have to be done all in one at same time. And, you know, this is typical what Dr. Pelle calls as a super hip procedure. But necessary it is, if you divide the procedure, each is not so super, which is a small surgery. And, you know, this is what the principle. Lengthening can be done later. So at this age also, the principles would remain same. They will not change.
Yeah. So I'll just move ahead. And the MRI which was done did not show any changes of AVN. Like Taral sir has pointed out, there are soft tissue contractures, there is deformity, there is a pseudoarthrosis of neck, and acetabulum is shallow. So management options are like super hip procedures, where you do a soft tissue release, deformity correction, achieve union at the neck pseudoarthrosis, and if required, do a pelvic osteotomy, which will be a stable fixation. So this is just a pictorial from Palais, what Taral sir was talking about, that he has achieved the union at the neck and stabilized the femur, and then subsequently he has lengthened the femur. So I will just quickly go through what Shinde sir has done. So he has done it in two stages. In first stage, he has done a sartorius, rectus and adductors, and gracialis myotomies. And then he has given a skeletal traction with the pin, and so that to bring the in second stage, he has done a fixation with a subtrochanteric abduction osteotomy with an anterolateral approach. And this is the fixation. So any comments from the faculty? Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Any comments from Shinde sir, Taral sir, Sandeep sir?
Actually, Shinde sir himself is a big proponent of the fibula graft. This is probably one place
Is the DHS placement correct? Has it cut out superolaterally? I don't know whether it...
It appears that, but in subsequent x-rays also it has remained same.
No, I don't know. Because he is adolescent, as you said, there is hardly any cartilage there which is going to reossify.
Yeah.
Medially, inferomedially, I am seeing a gap.
Yeah.
The screw seems to be cut out from the neck superolaterally, is my opinion. So I don't know.
Did you graft this? Yeah, did you graft this primarily, Rajiv?
I think Shinde sir might be able to tell us more about it.
Yeah. Now, considering his age, I had not done bone grafting.
Okay. Yeah. So this is I
do agree the placement of the Richard is not good, but some problem was there and I accepted this reduction.
No problem. So what would these areas have to be grafted? So we need to add some osteogenic potential. You can do it in various ways. Pelle does it by injecting BMP. What we do is I would put either iliac crest graft or a fibula graft, make a opening and do it. So some sort of grafting is necessary, otherwise these don't heal.
I'll just quickly go ahead and
please sir.
So this was his union and this is his 9-year-old 9-year follow-up.
Okay.
Very nice.
Yeah, so it's united. Yeah,
it's united. And
so one more. Yeah, so what is the clinical picture?
Yeah, he has a residual almost 5 centimeters of shortening. And this is his clinical video at maybe some days ago.
Right. Nice.
Yeah, his LLD has been corrected by 2.5 centimeters, and presently it is only 2.5 centimeters remain. And he is walking with compensatory chappals and shoes. And for 2.5 centimeters, he didn't turn up. For this presentation, 2 days back, I contacted him at Ambezogai. One of resident of Raviraj is lecturing in Ambezogai Medical College. It is his courtesy, he has found out him. And he has given all this record to us. This is 9-year follow-up because of Jeet, a resident of Raviraj, who has become a MS Ortho and lecturer from JJ Hospital.
Absolutely. So this again says that, it is possible to get long-term follow-ups, even this COVID situation. And I'll tell you, I wanted to share with everybody that, these are cases which do require long-term follow-up. I would specially mention growth modulation, where we put 8 plates to correct deformities. people have not been able to follow up since March. And you would know that from March, if somebody was to have implant removal in April, and if he's stuck because, you know, we have three cases of overcorrection because of that. And now I've realized that, you know, if all the orthopedic surgeons come together and nowadays what we are doing is calling up all the patients of growth modulation and asking them to go to a doctor which is near that
nearby.
So Dr. Shinde, Maharashtra Orthopedic Association in this way can do a good job. You know, everyone's follow-ups can be managed across the districts, you know, and I'm sure that the friendship which we have goes beyond these webinars and goes beyond just a conference into actual practice. And this is what binds us together and we need to learn together. Sandeep, you want to summarize and then we will come to Dr. Shinde.
No, I think it was a wonderful session which clarified a lot of early and late presentations of Perthes and DDH, and we could squeeze in a couple of other cases too. Hip can go on forever, sir, but we have to stick to some timing, otherwise we will never end this. The next Sunday, Taral is going to be the convener with Mandar probably, and they are going to talk about all the fractures, non-unions around the hip and probably infection and its sequelae. Correct, Taral?
So we will cover the trauma and slips next time.
And infections is separate.
Infection. So all infections, we are going to all bundle infections. Up together and manage.
Bundle up together. So next time will be traumatic hip session, acute, neglected, infected and slips. So we can have more of done and not to be done types.
Pathological fractures, fresh, all kind of trauma, you know, whatever you can think, which is traumatic by etiology or effect will be
included. Or traumatic surgery.
Yes. So thank you everybody.
Thank you very much and I'll hand over.
Dr. Shinde, please, you know, final remarks from me.
It's wonderful session. Only one thing I want to ask you, whether next time we are going to include infective problems in avian or only traumatic lesions we are considering next time.
Yeah, fresh neck fracture femur, delayed presentation fracture neck femur, pathological fracture neck femur and slip capsule femoral epiphysis. As you saw, sir, today only two topics also, it takes more than 2 hours. So we will cover the other part of the hip next time. And septic hip and sequelae, Taral will cover when we are dealing with all osteomyelitis and septic infection.
So we will do it all, but step by step, one at a time. So thank you, everybody. And please, same time next Sunday at 5 o'clock, reserve it for pediatric fractures around the hip. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm stopping that.